Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I ask unanimous consent to enter the record. Dear colleague, letter from Speaker Pelosi dated September 23rd, relevant part reads, we also expect that he will establish a path for the whistleblower to speak directly to the House and Senate Intelligence Committees as required by law.
Without objection.
Thank you. I look forward to you honoring that statement from the Speaker. Attorney Ambassador, I for one want to thank you so very much for a long service, exemplary service for to our country and on behalf of our nation. Lots been said about what was going on around the phone call. I'd like to focus more on what's happened since then to you and your career and what's going on. So when you got the word, anytime a ambassador changes post, there's a process you go through to depict what you do next. And that happened in this instance. Can you give us a quick statement as to how what happened when you came back here as to what your next assignment would be at this state?
So when I came back, obviously it was sort of out of cycle. There was nothing set up.
Sure.
And again, I am grateful that Deputy Secretary Sullivan asked me what I would like to do next. I recalled that there was the fellowship at Georgetown and asked whether that might be something that could be arranged.
Was that your only choice?
I'm not sure. We didn't really discuss other options.
My sense is Georgetown is fertile ground for State Department recruitment of future fledgling Foreign Service officers, and so they now benefit from your experience and your inspiration to inspire them to have spend their professional life in service to our nation.
Thank you.
You're a fellow there. You teach classes. How many classes do you teach?
This semester I was supposed to teach two. I am still teaching one on national security. The other one was on Ukraine, and I asked whether I could,
defer on that. How many students in your class? Approximately.
There are, 14, 15.
Right. Any other responsibilities at state other than the fellowship at Georgetown?
Well, I will tell you that all of this has kept me very busy.
Okay, I got that. But no necessarily day-to-day things that you'd be responsible for. Other than not qualifying for overseas stipends and other things, has your compensation been affected by being recalled the way you were?
No, it has not.
Okay. I'm worried about the way you might be treated by your fellow employees at state. Any negative, are they hold you in less high regard than they used to as a result of this? Do they shun you at the lunch counter? Do they treat you badly as a result of the way you were treated by the president?
I've actually received an outpouring of support from my colleagues.
So the folks that you respect the most still respect you and appear to hold you in high regard and high affection?
They do.
Okay. George Kent was in here a couple of days ago. He made some exemplary statements about you, really glowing. All of us, I think, would like to be the recipient of something that worthy, and I believe you are as well. Any reason on earth that you can think of that George Kent would be saying that because of some reason other than the fact that he believes it in his heart of hearts?
Like what?
Well, I mean, like somebody paid him to do it.
Oh, no, absolutely
okay, so
not.
You and I agree that we think he was sincere in that bragging on you, and that's all post recall episode that has been much of the discussion this morning. Well, I'm glad that your colleagues, I would have expected nothing any different from your colleagues at state to continue to treat you with the high regard that you've earned over all these years of great service. And I hope that whatever you decide to do after the Georgetown Fellowship, that you're as successful there as you've been in the first 33 years. With that, I yield the balance of my time to Mr. Jordan.